In chapter 12 of The Time Machine, the intrepid explorer returns, pointing out that as he approaches his laboratory, he notices that the machine sets down in a different place in the laboratory from which it started. He washes, dines, and gathers his friends together to tell them his story. He doesn't expect them to believe him, telling them to take it as a lie or a prophecy. The editor sarcastically remarks that it's sad the time traveler is not a fiction writer. The time traveler replies that he himself hardly believes what has happened. Examining the flowers, the medical man notes that he's never seen anything with their biology before. Leaping to his feet, the time traveler insists on confirming that there really is such a machine in his laboratory. Leading the men to his laboratory, the machine is indeed there, with bits of grass and dirt stuck to it. The time traveler then states unequivocally, "The story I told you was true." The narrator and the editor share a cab home. The editor thinks the story is a lie. The next morning, the narrator, intrigued and not knowing what to think, returns to the time traveler's house. He finds him carrying a knapsack and a camera. He asks him point blank if he really travels through time. The time traveler absolutely does. He invites the narrator to stay for lunch, but to excuse him for half an hour as he leaves to travel, to gather and bring back specimens to prove it was and is all real. After the time traveler disappears down the corridor to his laboratory, the narrator suddenly remembers he has an appointment. He goes to the laboratory. There, he sees a ghostly, indistinct figure sitting in a whirling mass of black and brass. It's the time traveler and the time machine taking off, never to return. The key words in this chapter are in the time traveler's challenge to his listeners, to take his story as either a lie or a prophecy. This could be Wells speaking to the reader through his character. On one level, of course, the story is absolutely a lie. It's a novel or a work of fiction. On the other, he is also giving himself an out as a writer. Wells' novel presents a bleak vision of the future in order to stimulate the reader to do something to prevent it. Clearly, the wealthy, educated upper class needs greater challenges and fewer opportunities to exploit the lower class. And the working class needs improvement of its living conditions and educational opportunities. To keep the two classes from diverging through millennia of evolution, both biological and social, as radically as the Eloi and Morlocks do, changes must be made to bring the classes closer together.